Okay, great. May all that I say and all the chizik that we gain bring nachat ruach to Hashem yidbarach, invoke rachamei shamayim for all those in need of yeshuot and nechamot, and serve as a zechut for Klal Yisrael. Amen. Does it say record? Oh, it says record?
Here it should be pushed in.
Okay. Okay, good. And just pay attention to the light. Make sure that, yeah. In particular, please, Hashem, may all that we say and all the chizuk that we gain today bring refuah shleima, in particular, to all those who were who are still injured and who are fighting literally for their lives from the latest horrible, horrible terrorist act last week in Yerushalayim and Har Nof. Please, Hashem, send them a complete healing, refuat ha-nefesh, refuat ha-guf. May there be nechama, and may the families be embraced with emuna and chizuk and koach to be able to get through this very, very, very difficult time, in particular, you know, the families who went through it on their own. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, that's what we're going to talk about today. Welcome, everyone. It's exciting to have a morning class. Let's first start by saying, okay, so what we're going to do, and also for all our viewers on TorahAnytime.com, we started this new Monday morning class for the women who are not able to come on Tuesday night. Their eyes just can't keep themselves open for whatever reasons, or mommy, you know, the kids are hanging on our coat, because I have that, my daughter hanging, mommy! Coming back ever? Are you ever going to be back? Again, you have a shear again. Who's giving it? Are you or somebody else? Like, it's always the same. Yeah. So, Baruch Hashem. So, we're starting this Monday morning class, and what we'll do is we'll do 1 week in Hebrew, 1 week in English. Bezlat Hashem, we're going to keep it tied to the Parsha. Today is a little bit different because we're going to talk about Kislev and the light of Kislev. But in general, it'll be attached to the Parsha, Bezlat Hashem. And it'll be, like I said, 1 week in Hebrew, 1 week in English. So for those also on TorahAnytime.com, they'll know, why do I once have it in Hebrew, once I have it in English? So that's the way we're going to be doing it. In addition, there will be still that same Tuesday night class in English, according to the Parsha. Because that's my keva. That's like how the Daily Dose of Emuna started with the shurim, something that I won't give up. Bezlat Hashem, until 120. I feel very connected to my Tuesday night women and class, and just the time is just, when it's keva, it's keva. There's a bracha in, you know, creating consistency in Torah learning. As far as this week is concerned, there's going to be Bezlat Hashem tomorrow night, Tuesday night, the 25th of November. A live webinar through Aish Webinars. The link to sign up is on the homepage of the website. Jewish workshops, something or another. Like I said, the web on the homepage of DailyDoseOfEmuna.com. There's the link. Sign up. What I'm going to be talking about is something that I've never spoken about before, and that's really my personal story: how I went from becoming a caterer, a chef by profession, to doing what Hashem has given me the zechut to do right now, and that is to teach Emuna. I call myself, or as people have called me, an Emuna mentor and a source of Bezlat Hashem emotional strengthening through Emuna. And Bezlat Hashem, I'm going to talk and disclose that it hasn't been an easy journey. To go from here to there, you have to go through the mud. You got to sometimes go through the mud and lift yourself up. And that's really what has happened to me. I'm sure many of us have our story. So I'll be telling that tomorrow. And then after, for those who continue to want to enjoy this series, it'll be on Monday nights, the webinar. We will have a four-part series, Emuna webinar, based on the four Emuna buttons. And the four Emuna buttons are, it's all from Hashem, there's purpose. Number two, Hashem is my father, he loves me. Number three, it must be good, there's ultimate meaning, and it's good whatever I'm going through now. And the fourth, which sums it all up, is what is the message? How can we understand Hashem's messages? So that's really the four-part Emuna series that'll be followed after this introduction tomorrow on the webinar. Okay. Now that I've done the introduction, let's get moving. Let's see how we can shine some light onto Kislev. So today, as we stand here, as we sit here, we all feel a tremendous envelopment in terms of the darkness that's permeating our lives. Let me just explain something. When I talk about Emuna, I always daven to Hashem, and we should always, always daven to Hashem. Please, as we say every morning, don't put me in front of a nisayon. We're not asking Hashem, you know, test me, test me. David HaMelech even asked for it, and he, you know, didn't pass the test in flying colors. We ask Hashem not to put us in front of a nisayon. Why? The next verse, the next few words following is, so I won't be in front of what's called a bizayon. A bizayon means, so I won't be brought down to my knees with humiliation, knowing that I just wasn't able to pass through it. So we don't want, and we don't ask for tests. And we learn Emuna in order to store in our Emuna storehouse enough koach so that, God forbid, when the trials and tribulation of life come at our doorstep, if it's personally or collectively, we have where to pull. The time to work on Emuna is not when there's a nisayon. That's key. That's key to acquiring Emuna. It has to be part of our daily routine. Literally stuffing in the warehouse, more Emuna, more Emuna, more koach, more insight, more clarity, more connection, adhering myself more and more, tighter and tighter and tighter, clearing off all of the distractions and barriers that may come in between me and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So when the time comes, God forbid, and I'm shaken about, nothing could really pull me away. I'm so stuck. I've worked so hard on painting myself with that glue, with the crazy glue, so nothing can tear me away from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And that is key. We cannot start working on our Emuna when an earthquake, you know, when an earthquake happens, it's not the time to start nailing down your furniture. We have to do that before. And so that's the key, and that's why I encourage everyone, it doesn't have to be through me, but equip yourself with learning Emuna. Equip yourself with learning Emuna so that you can put on that armor. So God forbid when the earth starts shaking underneath us, and unfortunately as we get closer to Mashiach, I don't see much of, I mean, please God, I'm wrong, and the Rebbeim who say that this is, but it's going to get tough. It's gonna get tough, and we really need to equip ourselves. And so it's important to learn Emuna, because I'm telling you, there's gonna come a time, and I've been saying this a lot because it's coming rapidly. There's going to come a time where we're gonna sit, God forbid, in the middle of a tragedy, and we're gonna say to ourselves, "That's it, Hashem gave up on us. That's it, we're done. We're crying and Hashem's not listening. And we're going to feel we've lost it. We've lost the war. Hashem abandoned us." Just like the Goyim say, he's got fed up with you. He chose another nation. We're going to feel, that's it. They were right all along. We're left at our own wits. We're that's it. We're done. We're thrown at the wayside. We've lost the war. We're never going to earn back Eretz Yisrael. We're never going to earn back the glory of Am Yisrael. And I'm telling you, it's going to come to every single one of us. And I'm telling you, at that point, don't listen. Don't listen to that inner voice, because it's not true. Because that's exactly what the Baal Shem Tov and all of the Rebbeim all along have told us. Haster astir panai. It's going to be a double concealment. And we feel it now. The double concealment of Hashem, as if we don't even know he's hiding anymore. We don't even think he's even hiding, because when we know he's hiding, we can go and seek him out. That's already Mela. I know he's hiding, so I can already start moving my furniture. I can look underneath my table. I can start pulling things apart. I could start looking for him, because when you know someone's hiding, you know that he's there. He's there, hide and seek. I know you're there. I just have to keep looking. But when I don't even think that he's, God forbid, hiding anymore, I stop looking. That's Yeush. That's despair. And that's exactly what Rabbi Nachman teaches us. En yeush ba'olam klal. There's no such thing. There's always a place to look for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Turn over every rock, tear apart every corner. Hashem is there. And never, ever, ever get to the point where you think that Hashem is not here and not there, not here with us. Always remember that. And please, you know, pass it on to your friends. Make sure everyone knows. There might be a time where that may come about to be so strong. But please, God, you know, that we should, you know, be able to uplift ourselves and not fall to that, you know, place of despair. And so this month, the month of Kislev, teaches us in particular what it means to live in Choshech, to live in darkness. If there's any month of the year that's physically, in terms of physicality, the darkest month of the year, Chazal teach us it's Kislev. This month is the darkest month of the year in terms of days being the shortest and nights being the longest. In fact, Hanukkah, the week of Hanukkah, falls the longest night of the year. Dafka Chag HaEmuna, the holiday of Emuna, Chag Hanukkah, where it's we see miracles, five Avrechim, five Kollel Bachors, equip themselves with bow and arrow and go and say, I'm going to fight America. Hello? Like, what are you thinking? Like, where are your tanks? Where's the big, right? Jabal people, guys in the back, like behind you? We're going. We're with Hashem. And so in that darkness of totally irrationality, how can that happen? They went with the Emuna, and so Chag Hanukkah is the Chag of Emuna, that no matter how much darkness there is around us, there is light. And today we're going to talk about the steps of being able to see the revelation through Sefer Yetzirah, the book that was authored by Avraham Avinu, how he taught us through the Arizal, the explanation of the Arizal, Arizal brought down that every month has its particular energy, its particular sense, its particular letter, its particular avoda. And in this month, the avoda is Emuna, but in a strong, very strong, intense way. In this month, the zodiac sign is the bow and arrow. And we can learn a lot of messages of Emuna by the bow and arrow. Let's go one by one. The bow and arrow, first of all, I have to pull it all the way back. I have to be pressured and tensed. I got to pull it. And the more I use my strength to pull back, what happens? The farther it flies and the further away I can reach. That's the story of Emuna, of Hishtadlus versus Emuna. The more I feel like, yes, okay, I am, I'm pulling back, but who's giving me the strength to be able to pull myself back, to be able to interact with this world? HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I'm pulling back, but when I'm pulling back, it also requires a lot from me, a lot of tension. Hashem says, I'm going to pull you all the way back. I'm going to cause such tension, but guess what? It's for the purpose of us to be able to fly. It's for the purpose of us to be able to reach greater, further distances in our lives. So all the nisyonot, all the hardships, all of the difficulties, all the tension that every single one of us is going through, again, I say it again, individually and collectively as a nation, it's all in order for us to be able to reach further distance, be able to reach HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and God willing, feel like we're closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Another insight that we learn from the bow and arrow also is when I'm pulling it back, I have my eye on a target. And I'm sure that I'm going to hit there. I mean, I could see the bullseye. It's all nice and clear to me. And the minute I let go, it's out of my hands. And that's another lesson of Hishtadlus. I do as much as I can. I try hard. I'm pulling myself as much as I possibly can. But I have to know at one point I got to let go. And once I let go, even though I think I've done everything to hit my target, what can happen? An easterly wind blows the arrow and totally takes it off track. And it falls to a totally different destination. I have to know I'm doing all that I can to reach a certain point in my life. But what does the pasuk teach us in Torah? Lo alecha hamelacha ligmo. It's not incumbent upon us to fulfill and accomplish. Only for us to interact with this world to the best of our ability. The best of our ability, we have to try. We have to do our hishtadlus. That's what Hashem says. But where is it going to fall? Where am I going to reach? Not in my hands. And in that is embedded the whole idea of trust. I do what I can. Hashem, I beg, I plead, I have tefillah, whatever I have to do. But at the end of the day, where it's going to hit, not incumbent upon me. The other thing is when I pull the arrow downward, where is it going? It's soaring upward. And that's a little bit of a lesson that we can learn in terms of our tefillah. The lower we feel, the closer to the ground we feel, the more lowliness I experience, it helps me tense up myself to the point where I feel I have nowhere else to go but to soar upward, to bring my tefillahs upward, and to feel myself connected to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So it's an amazing thing that not for nothing that even the zodiac sign has within it a message of emuna and trust. The tribe of the month is the tribe of Binyamin. Binyamin is the tribe that was most beloved to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He's the tribe that was also gifted with the whole idea because he was a warrior. That was his persona, is that he fought wars. And so he, not for no reason, was gifted to be talented in that whole sport of archery that also is connected to him. The letter of the month. This is phenomenal. The letter of the month is Samach. The pasuk in Ashrei, Somech Hashem l'chol ha'nuflim v'zokef l'chol ha'kfufim. Hashem uplifts all those that have fallen, right? And makes them stand upright to all those who feel that they are slouched down. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is telling us that in this month, in the month of darkness, let's understand, darkness means the absence of light. What is light? Light in terms of Torah means pleasure. Spiritual pleasure. What is spiritual pleasure? What is oneg? Oneg means the idea of attaching myself to the source of all good. The source of all good meaning HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So when we say light and when we say dark, what we're meaning is the attachment to Hashem, the feeling of His presence, living in Emuna versus darkness where I'm lost and I'm confused and I don't have my spiritual GPS in tune to be able to attach myself to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to meaning, to clarity, to know where I'm going. So it's darkness as opposed to confusion as opposed to clarity. And so this month, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, through the darkness of the month, Hashem says, I'm telling you that this is the month you can feel that even in your darkness you have who to lean on. So Samach Somech, you have who to lean on. Now we want to know that we're leaning on something steady, right? Because if I'm leaning on something wobbly, what does it mean? I'm unsure. I don't know. Can I really count on it? But the idea is for us to understand that when we lean on a Kadosh Baruch Hu, it's the pillar of life. It's the most sturdiest pillar that I can possibly lean on. There is no chance of me falling. And even if I do fall, even that's under Hashgacha. Even that's divinely ordained. I have to understand that even my falling means that I should lift myself up, because what does Chazal teach us? That Dafka, a tzaddik, falls. But what does he do? He picks himself up. And that's the difference. If we want to uplift ourselves to the level of becoming righteous, we have to know we're going to fall. No question we're going to fall. And the falling is intentional and specifically to the minute detail also guided by Hashem. Hashem says, yes, you're going to fall so that you know that you lift yourself up when you're down on the ground. You lift yourself up and you know I'm going to carry you. And where do we see this? Look at the amazing way the letter Samach is written in the Torah. It has a line on top, right? A straight line. And then it has a circle. So first of all, two things. One, what does it teach us? That in order for me to be able to really truly trust in a Kadosh Baruch Hu, I have to see the full circle. I'm right now, all of us right now, the circle hasn't closed yet. We're still in the middle of the galus. We're still in the middle of the difficulty. We haven't seen full circle. We cannot judge anything about what's going on in our lives unless I see full circle, right? I always use the analogy, I can't walk into a movie an hour late and expect to understand what's going on in the plot, right? Why is he shooting? Why? Oh, he died. Oh, for all I know, the person who died was a mass murderer and he deserved to die. But, I just feel like crying because someone died. I don't know. I'm in the middle of the movie. I'm in the middle of the circle. I haven't seen the full hoop attach itself. Second beautiful insight, which is the most amazing insight of this month, is Dafka this month, we see the straight line. The straight line is the parable to Shemayim. The line is the Shemayim. And then what comes down from Shemayim? This long, right? This half circle. What does that Chazal teach us? That's Hashem's hand scooping from underneath, from Shemayim, and lifting us up. Somech. And Hashem says, here, right over here, put your head. Let me, like a baby, right? We put the baby right here in the crouch of the arm. Hashem says, come, just lay on me. Lean on my shoulder. Lean on my hand. And I'm going to rock you like a baby. And I'm telling you, you can rely on me. I'm here for you. But lean on me. I'm telling you, you're not going to make it through this world unless you lean on me. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I'm telling you, the galut's going to be hard, it's going to be long, it's going to seem like I'm not there, but call on to me. When you call on to me, when you tell me that you need me, I will appear. But you have to know that you have to call me. Call me. You're not going to make it through without calling me. And so that's the big message of any time when, God forbid, anyone finds themselves in a place of darkness, of difficulty, know you have who to call. You're not alone. You just need to reach out. Be'ezrat Hashem. The organ of the month is the keva, the belly. Now we know when our bellies are nice and full, when we've eaten a good meal, how calm, how satiated, what a smile we have, right? They say, what do you do when your husband walks through the door? Here, honey, take a drink, have food, sit down, let me feed you. Don't start, blah, blah, blah. You know what the kids did to me today? You know the checks bounced today? No. Have a seat, sit down. I prepared you your favorite food. Feed them, because you cannot talk to someone who's hungry. You cannot talk to someone, right? Lechem, from the word milchama. When a person wants lechem, when he wants to eat bread, he's involved. That's right. We see this, unfortunately, at kiddushes, right? Oh, yeah. Unfortunately. Milchama. Milchama. Anytime it comes to food, we feel we have to fight. We have to fight in order to satiate ourselves because we need it. That's the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Yes, we have to tame our animalistic side to us, but the bottom line is we know that when our stomach is full, when we're satiated, when we've been able to drink our coffee, have our little cake, whatever it is, we feel calm. And that's also a hint to the idea that this month we're able to satiate our stomach with what we need in order to experience that calmness. And where do we see this again? Look how it's layer upon layer. All the messages of this month is tranquility, calmness in the midst of darkness. What is the sense, the action of the month? The action of the month is sleep. So now sleep can have this side and that side. At one hand, we could say, oh, it's dark. It's what do we do in the winter? We become, right, the bears that hibernate. We close the door. We don't want to hear anyone. We don't see anyone. We don't go to any shurim. It's raining. I can't go out, right? Forget there's an umbrella out there. No, we want to be isolated. It's the months where we turn inside of ourselves. So on one hand, it's not good. That's an avoda that we have to do. We have to realize that sleep is good. Sleep is important, but not when we take it to the other extreme where we want to shut ourselves down and we don't want to cope, right? In fact is, a lot of our generation today, we're tired. I'm tired. It's a physiological manifestation and expression of the fact that we don't want to deal with life, right? We don't want to deal with life. In fact is, I'm going to teach you something that I just learned recently, which is amazing. When a baby comes down into this world, the baby has gone through, this is very off the subject, but I'm sure you're going to find this fascinating because we're a bunch of also young mothers here. When a baby, right, or young grandmothers, okay, so we still get to get experience, right? I'm a grandmother, So the idea is when a baby comes into this world, the baby goes through two major traumas. I don't know if anybody knows this. This is an amazing lesson for life. The first trauma is the neshama. Before it comes down into this world, the neshama is next to the divine radiance. It's basking in the most, if you can imagine taking the most amazing place that you can fathom, it's not that. Even more so, it's not even that. Even more so, I'm telling you, it's not even that. It's something we cannot fathom. The most amazing place that anyone could possibly fathom in the wildest, wildest dreams, take it further, and that's where it is. And that's where the neshama comes from. The neshama of our little babies that come out of our womb. And this neshama is I don't know, metaphorically, if we can imagine just like basking away at this amazing light, this beautiful pleasure. And Hashem says, I'm sorry, honey, you got to go down. I gotta send you off. She was like, no, you can't, I don't want to go anywhere else. And Hashem says, I'm really sorry, I for your own good. I'm going to send you a place where yes, you're going to have to work really, really, really hard to feel me, but the reward of earning it, bless you, is going to be so enormous, it's going to be worth it. It's going to be worth it. And so the neshama has to actually sign on a contract that it swears to be loyal and dedicated to its avoda in this work. And it's shown the entire lifespan. Everything that it's going to be going through, Hasidut teaches us. Everything. We choose our parents, we choose our spouse, we choose our children, we choose our lifestyle, we choose our health, we choose everything we have chosen, and we sign on this spiritual contract. I hereby abide that I will be loyal and righteous and continue to strive to be loyal to my tafki, to my mission in life. And it takes 1,000 years for this neshama to come from the divine holy throne down into the mommy's womb. Can you imagine how traumatized this soul is? It's just been sent away from the most amazing place in the entire existence. And it's being told now it has to go to work in order to achieve a higher state than what it was. It can't even fathom that there exists such a place. Then, wow, it finally makes it into the womb of the mother. This has to do with what we spoke about, okay? I'm not off my subject. And makes its way into the womb and feels the beautiful warmth and love of a mother, of a Jewish mother. And who is it given as a partner? It's Chavruta, the angel from above, who sits there day and night, Steig and Torah, with this neshama. And suddenly the neshama feels this amazing light again and feels, wow, this is fantastic. I'm somewhat back to enjoying. And he gets to see from one side of the world to the next and has this amazing light, the light of Emuna, which every single one of us has right here on our keter, on our crown of creation. It's right here. Our Emuna is always circling around us. And I don't want to leave this place. This is amazing. Hashem was right. I found it. I really am in an amazing place. And finally, I found it. And boom, it's getting squeezed out. By out you go. And then this beautiful angel, which was so amazing to me, bang, smacks me on the mouth, says, sorry, I'll see you after 120. Remember what you learned with me. You'll have to recite it all back. You'll have a test after 120. Remember what you learned on day 125. Yep. Okay. And the baby comes out into this world. That's trauma two. Trauma one, being taken away from the holy throne. Trauma two, now it's being thrown into this world. And so we wonder why a baby sleeps on the average of 17 hours a day. This baby truly has gone through two of the most intense traumatizing experiences, and it never forgets, and it never finds itself. And so therefore the baby needs constantly the loving reassurance from mom and dad that it's okay. I know it's really hard for you to adjust into this world. And every time the baby wakes up, it cries. It's like, really? Where am I? I don't want to be here. Literally, it's an expression of the soul of not wanting to be here in this world. And it takes the baby 3 months, literally, to get adjusted. And that's why the baby colic, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why the baby, that's just a physical reason, but this is the real reason, can't adjust to this world. It came from the most spiritual source. It's been given the most spiritual gifts. It doesn't relate to this world in any which shape or form. And that's why it can't see. The baby can't see. The baby can't hear. The baby can't feel. It has none of the physical ability to interact with this world because it's not a physical being. It's in the realm still of spirituality. And so why am I saying that? Is that sleeping, the baby sleeping on the, when we're looking at sleeping from the negative aspect, it could mean, I just don't want to deal with this world. That's how I got into this whole thing. Okay, there is a reason to my madness, right? The idea is that when you sleep, for negative purposes, it's just a sense of denial. I just don't want to deal with it. And so many, many times we also don't realize we have headaches, we have backaches, we have all these aches and pains because we literally cannot deal with life. And so the idea is how important it is for us to actually work with our emuna so that we can, because we can deal with life. Again, if we invite Hashem into our lives to help, right? Hashlech al Hashem yavcha, v'hu yichalkelecha, cast away your burden. What happens when I cast away my burden, when I lean on something? Then whatever I'm holding on to, right? It's not all on me. It's not all on me. Hashem says, you can't hold it all down. I'm telling you, right? Again, I keep saying it. You cannot do it. Lean on me. Give me some of your burden. And then you won't have the sense of wanting to sleep your life away, right? You'll be waking up in the morning enthused at the fact that you're going to be challenged, but you have the best partner in the world, the boss, the master planner of the universe, the supreme authority that knows how to carry it and knows how to direct and guide us to whatever it is that we need to endure. But on the flip side, on the positive side, sleep is also a very positive thing if I sleep peacefully. You see, when I sleep, if I'm not sleeping with trust, if I'm sleeping with a sense of, where am I? Did you hear that? What's going on? I think the bed is not steady. Who put together? I think I'm going to fall. Where's my pillow? Anyone underneath my bed? How do I sleep at night? Sleep teaches me, if I sleep well, that means I'm sleeping with emuna. I'm sleeping with trust, right? So to the positive aspect of sleeping, if I sleep calmly, I'm sleeping with trust. I'm not worried. I know I'm going to bed. Bezalat Hashem, I'll wake up, right? I'm gonna be equipped for the challenges of life. I understand that what I went through today, if I do Bezalat Hashem tshuva every night for even 3 minutes, and I've gone through everything that I need to improve the following day, then I've even utilized all the experiences and uplifted myself from everything. I can release myself from that burden because sin weighs down on us. In fact, as Chazal teaches, that transgressions are the far most strongest barrier and strongest powerful reason for us to feel fear. When I feel fear of any kind, mostly what I'm feeling is a spiritual aspect of fear, meaning I feel like I've sinned, and so I don't feel worthy of Hashem's hashgacha and his one-on-one guidance. But if I unburden myself, if I do tshuva, especially before I go to sleep, then I could sleep better. Because I know that I've unburdened it. I've done my tshuva. I've cleaned my slate, and I feel worthy of Hashem's hashgacha. It's a subconscious feeling that we all have when we're fearful of something. I'm telling you, if we all did tshuva, we would feel worthy of Hashem's care. We wouldn't be so scared of what's going on. We wouldn't have the worries that we have, if it's personally or again collectively, of what's going on in this world. We would be more rest assured. It's very important to wipe out that sense of fear by unburdening us ourselves and doing tshuva on the spot. We don't wait for Yom Kippur. We're a nation that doesn't wait for Yom Kippur every day. Doing tshuva on the spot. I got someone upset, my child, I screamed at them when it... Right on the spot. I'm sorry, mommy just lost it. I had a really tough day. I'm human. What can I do? I'm working on myself just like you are. Be real. We have to be real with ourselves, and we have to be real in front of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So sleep in that sense could also have a very positive attribute. I'm trying to see. Okay, a few more minutes. Any questions? Okay?
Can I add to your baby story?
Yeah. Love.
I heard something also about when the baby comes down and it comes out of the womb, it takes its first breath, and the lungs are not, they're breathing for the first time. So the lungs actually tear.
Oh, I did not know that. Physically?
With the first breath, yeah. The first
breath. So then how does it?
Tears the tissue in the lung to allow air in for the first time.
I did not know that.
And so it's like tearing away from.
Wow. And you know the lungs is the place for the ruach. Is where the ruach, that's the second level of the soul.
Right.
Wow, that's amazing. Right. See, it's probably so big. The soul is so big, it literally tears apart the body. That's very interesting. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Kislev, let's look at the month, the way that it's written. Kis, kaf, samach, lev, lamed, vav. We're going to look at three different aspects. So kis, first of all, is kaf, samach, comes from the word kisui. Covering. So now let's look at Lev, Lamed Vav. We can look at it from three different angles. Either it's Kislev, even though it's spelled Lamed Vav, it's really Lev, a covering of our heart. Where in this month, because physically we are in the darkest month, it's the month where we feel that our heart can, it's just numb. Many of us, unfortunately, fortunately, as a defense mechanism, we cover our hearts. Now, on one hand, the spiritual anesthesia that Hashem injects in every single one of us is good. That's why we have to work so hard to pierce through in order to attain spirituality. Because on one hand, Hashem gave us this injection called spiritual anesthesia in order that we should be able to make it through the galut without falling apart. So on one hand, it's good. On the other hand, we have to pierce through, even through that anesthesia, and obtain what it is that we need in order to survive and to make that vital connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu in order to make it through. But it has to come through our avoda, through our actual, you know, interaction with this world. So this month, when it's the month, and again, when we're saying this month, it means in a period of darkness. That's what I mean when I say the words this month. This month, or in any period of time of darkness that I'm going through in my life, I have to know that automatically I'm going to sense a covering over my heart. I'm going to become numb. I'm already going to give up hope. I'm already not going to have any more feelings of wanting to deal with it. I'm going to become numb. I may really go to the negative aspect of sleeping. I'm going to want to sleep it away, sleep it off, you know, tomorrow, whatever is going to be is going to be. I'm going to try to just get through it. But the idea is, and here we're going to go to the second part of the possibility of Kislev, it could mean that all it is a kis, a covering of Lamed Vav. Lamed Vav is the gematria 36, and 36 stands for revelation, like the 36 lights of Hanukkah. It could mean that really this darkness is just a cover for what is yet to be revealed to me, for the revelation of light that has yet to be revealed to me. Because as we know, the light of the sun is immense. It's beautiful. It's fantastic. We love it. We love to bask in the warmth of the sun. But the sun in its fullness, I can't enjoy. There has to be some sort of a filterization. Either I have to go under a tree, get some shade, I have to put some UV, right? Glasses. I cannot enjoy the full warmth. And so too HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I want to shine upon you all my love, the abundance. In fact, Chasidut teaches us that every moment that we're alive, Hashem showers us with abundance. The question is my vessel strong enough and am I able enough to receive it? Many times we don't feel the abundance because HaKadosh Baruch Hu delays it, because it's not for our good, because our vessel would otherwise break. We couldn't absorb the abundance that comes down. And therefore Hashem created the 10 spheres, the manifestation, that filterization of the way that it comes down into this world, because we cannot absorb it unless I prepare my vessel. How do I prepare my vessel? Emuna. When I go above and beyond my body, where we say Emuna is, right here. When I go beyond the limitations of my physicality, of my body, I go above and beyond the rationale, the intellect of my finite brain. I go beyond this world of being able to come up with a rational idea of why things are going on. Then I'm expanding myself. I'm reaching above myself. I'm creating a bigger vessel, and I'm able to absorb more light. More light of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I'm able to feel HaKadosh Baruch Hu in ways that I never was before. We're vessels of expansion. We can constantly expand ourselves. And that's the chesed. Chesed is expansion. The chesed that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants to give us is the expansion of ourselves. But I have to be willing to step out of myself. I have to be able to say to myself, I don't. It's okay. Emuna is understanding that I don't understand. Right? It's understanding that it's okay to also not understand, because that's the reason why I'm counting and leaning on HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I want to lean on someone stronger than me, right? Otherwise, what's the purpose of leaning? If I'm going to lean on something weaker and or the same as me, I'm just going to fall. I want to lean. I want to be in the hands of someone who knows better than me. And that's the whole inyan. We're trying to understand something that is beyond, and that's what weakens us. But we have to understand it's great that that's what makes a child feel secure, is knowing mommy knows. Mommy knows. I'm in good hands. Does he know exactly what mommy's doing or mommy has planned? No. But mommy knows better than me. She's bigger than me, right? So mommy understands. And so the whole idea is for us to take that baby approach, that childish approach of knowing that we have who to rely on. And so the idea of uncovering my heart means that I'm in the darkness so that HaKadosh Baruch Hu can reveal himself, so I can work towards the revelation. And also, for the last but not least, Kislev is Kes, the cover of Lamed Vav of Lo, right? Him. Lo could be also him, right? In the Hebrew language, Lo, Lamed Vav is him. It means that there is, which works into the revelation idea, is there is a covering of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and it's intentional. No, we should all know that we're in the darkness right now so that we will feel that we're in the darkness. Because the immense light that's about to, Be'ezrat Hashem, be revealed to us, Berachamim, soon, Be'ezrat Hashem, will be so powerful. But the way for HaKadosh Baruch Hu to shine his powerful light is in darkness. Because if I strike a match here right now in a well-lit room, I won't sense the light. The way to sense the light is dafka in the darkness. And it's from within the darkness that HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, you're going to find my light. But you have to, again, be willing to do that first move. Strike the match. Believe that there's light. And Hashem is going to show us, Be'ezrat Hashem, that light. And so that really pretty much sums up the hints of the month. But the bottom line message is that in any place that we find ourselves, is to always remember, even here in our tragedies, Hashem says, I want you to feel the pain. This pain is intentional. It's because HaKadosh Baruch Hu knows that when Am Yisrael are in pain, they come together and they're as one. What is the Shekhinah? The Shekhinah is the unification of all of the souls of Am Yisrael. And so, unfortunately, I mean, let's look at it. Let's be honest with ourselves. Unfortunately, we're not always together. But really, at times like this, we cry and we're together in tears. And so I proposed last week in the Shiur, just last Tuesday when this happened, as I proposed to all the women, and I hope that all of you will be willing to take to join me on this mission, is that we're going to tell Hashem that we don't need tragedies in order to cry and be together. We want to tell Hashem that measure, for whatever happened, unfortunately, in our nation, that for the most enormous, can you imagine the gzera that was on Am Yisrael? Hashem took four flowers, four amazing, amazing flowers. They came and they took the kapara, the atonement of who knows the gzera that should have been on Am Yisrael. I mean, I know that these amazing women, they've spoken about this. They know. They all feel it. They all know that it was supposed to be something very, very much, much bigger, God forbid. And so we want to tell Hashem, we don't need tragedy in order to come together. So I propose that the next time any single one of us hears a bit of a piece of good news, something that happened to a neighbor, a friend, a family, something has to do outside of my personal realm, not to my kid, not to my spouse, but I hear something that happened to someone else, I am going to dance and cry tears of joy as if it was my own. Measure for measure. I'm not going to just cry for someone else when they're going through tragedy, but I'm going to cry for them tears of joy when something amazing happens. And I'm going to call up my neighbors and I'm going to say, did you hear what happened to Sarah Rachel? Did you hear? Her son is getting married. Isn't that amazing? And I'm going to spread the news. I'm going to spread the news. I'm going to take it to heart. And I'm going to really rejoice. And when my kids come home, they're going to see mom dancing to the music. What happened, mom? Did you hear Sarah Rachel say that her son is getting married? Mom, you hardly even know Sarah. I don't care. A Jewish soul is going to be married. I'm happy. I'm going to cry tears of joy. I'm going to spread the word. I'm going to make sure it's plastered all over, you know, my Facebook and my email and everywhere I can possibly do. And that's how I'm going to prove to Hashem I don't need to be woken up just through tears of tragedy. Measure for measure. And Bezrat Hashem, we can create a movement. We can really come together b'simcha. And we can really dance at Sarah Rachel's son's, you know, I hope there's a Sarah Rachel who's marrying off her son soon, because I've just blessed her a million times. But the idea is to dance at that wedding as if it was my own son, because it is. It's part of my body. We just don't see it. We don't see it, but every child is my child, and we know that. And when do we know that? Times of tragedy. Times of tragedy, when we cry for those that are in pain. Why do we cry so much? Because we know it's our blood. We know it's our family. I don't care if I don't know this person in particular. It's my family. Something happened to my family member. And so we want to celebrate life, and we don't want to cry over the tragedies. Be'ezrat Hashem, this month, Dafka, the month of Choshech, of darkness, it's not for nothing that also Hashem, even this, look what a Hashem we have. That 4 days after this, Hashem brings us the month of Kislev. He says, I know you're in darkness. Look how Torah coincides with life. Hashem says, I know you're in darkness. I'm going to bring you the light of Kislev. You're going to see the light of Kislev. You're going to see the light of miracles, Be'ezrat Hashem. And Be'ezrat Hashem, we should really have the zchut to see, as I call it, revealed good, because everything's good, somehow or another. Why is it good? Because it serves something good. Not because the incident itself is good, but because somehow or another it's going to serve something good. Because we're on our way to Geula, Be'ezrat Hashem, and that's what we're davening for. And Be'ezrat Hashem should be revealed to us very, very soon. Amen.
Amen.
Can close it.